Hi, welcome to all the speakers and everyone watching Nari Talks first webinar of 2021. A big thank you to all the speakers for being a part of Nari Talks today. Today we have a panel of four speakers. We have with us Shanta Devi Ramanji. She is a lawyer with rich experience of litigation, arbitration and corporate advisory in diverse fields of law. She has handled over 100 plus cases in various jurisdictions of Honorable Supreme Court of India, High Court Commissions and Tribunals, and has reported and unreported cases to her credit. She was also awarded with the Empowered Woman Award 2020 by YMCA on Women's Day. Welcome, Shanta Ramanji.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me on your panel, and that too for such an energetic panelist. And that to a very, very important topic.
We are truly humbled to have you. Thank you for being here. The topic of today's webinar relates to the legal landscape of women's rights. In other words, how has the law evolved for women in the contemporary times? The struggle for women equality began in India in the 20th century during the struggle for independence. While some groundbreaking laws have been introduced for the welfare, security, and benefit of women, there are still several laws in India which officially favor men over women. Our first law that we would like to discuss talks about the inheritance law for women. A landmark verdict given by the Supreme Court in 2020 focused on expanding the Hindu woman's right to be a joint legal heir and inherit the ancestral property on terms equal to male heirs under the inheritance rights of 2005. What is the significance of this verdict for Hindu women? And what are the different categories of properties for which women can benefit from this law? I would request Shanta ji to please give her opinion on this.
For sure. In fact, this is a very right timing also to discuss about this topic, primarily because just a few months back, Honorable Apex Court has decided and conclusively has come to a point wherein that the daughters are no less than sons in the family. When the birth is being taken, when the right is being acquired by the son, when he takes birth, and why not for the daughters when they take birth in the same family? And we have been like this for the past so many years. You just see, in 1956, the law was codified on the Hindu Succession Act. The Hindu Succession Act itself, which was got codified, which got decided the laws, the how the ancestral property will devolve, and how the self-acquired property will devolve. It was codified in 1956. Even in 1956, this right was not provided. And it was on and on and on. In 2005, the amendment came. Just imagine, where is 1947 and where is 2005? To think as to that, at least the women, daughters in the family should have the same rights, if not the better rights. They need to have the same right. So that amendment came in 2005. When the amendment came in 2005, very categorically, it's a very small, section 6 is a long section, but that categorically it described that the women, the daughters, once they take birth in that family, then immediately they have the equal right. That is, and also liability, of course. It also talks about, the same section talks about liability also. So it was very clearly the statute brought in that very conscious amendment. And in 2005, after it brought in the amendment, still there was a little confusion and a gray area as to that, if the father whose property, because we are basically talking about joint Hindu family property. And wherein in 1956 Act, it talks about two different kinds of a situation. One is that members, the daughter, women, wife, the all women of the family, they become member, of course, they become member of the family, the Hindu family. But as far as the co-partners, when we talk about, they do not become a co-partners. The co-partners only get that right is given only to father to son, son to grandson, grandson to great-great-grandson. So it was a lineal descendant. So that difference, which was the Section 6 went amendment, which was a landmark amendment, which was brought in 2005, when it was brought in, then it was decided that it became very clearly, this was a purpose also. It said that the daughters also have a right. And why the confusion arose primarily because if the father is not alive in September 2005, when the amendment brought in, then what will happen? Will it also apply to the property which is not yet partitioned, but whether the daughters will get that right? This was a question. In 2016, there was a judgment which was passed in by the Honorable High Court, Honorable Supreme Court, the Prakash versus Phoolwati. This Phoolwati judgment said, it is two judges bench judgment. Phoolwati said, no, the father should have been alive when the statute brought in the amendment. Because amendments, basically, as per the constitution, as per law, every amendment is only prospective. It is never retrospective unless it is specified in the statute itself. So because of that, in 2016 judgment, Phoolwati judgment said the father should have been alive. Only then the daughters will get a right. Just 2 years after that, there was another bench, that again a two judges bench, in Dhanamma case, they said, no, this right accrues out of a birth of a child, girl child. So since because it is arising out of inheritance and arising out of birth, so whether the father is alive or not, it will definitely, the daughters will get it. So now there are two different judgments, both of the same strength. This is also two judges, that is also two judges, because of which a three judges bench in 2020 August considered all these aspects. And in fact, very clearly they said, whether the father was alive in 9-9-2005, that is the day, September 2005, that the day when the amendment was brought in, whether he was alive or not, the daughters will definitely get the equal right as that of son. Now, by this three judges bench judgment, the whole question and the controversy has been put into rest by very clearly saying that the daughters have the equal right, since because it arises out of the birth in the family. So this was put into rest. The section itself provides that the partition should not have occurred, and if the partition has already occurred in December 2004, in those cases it cannot be reopened. Wherein the partition has not occurred after December 2004, this will become applicable, that the statute, the section itself provides. So the same thing has been held in this judgment also, that wherever the partition has not taken place and beyond 2005, when the amendment was brought in, and whether it is the father is alive or is not, in every situation, the daughters have the wife, predeceased son's wife, everybody, all women in the family, all of them have a right. In fact, the Supreme Court says further also by saying that the daughters are more close. Daughters are eternally daughters to the family. At least a son, once he gets married, he does not remain as a son to this family. But daughters are so loving. The daughters, till the end, they remain as daughters. This is the word is given in the judgment itself. So this is a way the law also has recognized, and the Honorable Court has put it in such a nice way that even the daughters also feel that it is a pride and it has been recognized. So they have that, at least they are able to relate themselves to it with a pride and with a loving feeling that, yes, I am a daughter in this family and I have equal right. So this is the latest development which has come in.
No, it's actually amazing and a great step towards women equality and justice in India. And I think feminists, Indians, women, even men all over India, even staying abroad, have celebrated this verdict and have welcomed it with open arms. So getting into a little bit of the nuances of each act, I would want to start with the Inheritance Act, as mentioned by Shanta Ramanji. And it's not a legal question, Shantaji, it's more of from a social perspective. Something that, generally I've heard people say, and I've even seen women do, is that in order to avoid any discord in the family, they are forced, coerced, or you can say willingly, are giving away their share of the property to their brothers so as to, maintain that harmony in the family. And you know, this might be true, this might not be true for some people. What is your opinion in that case? You know, is there any monitoring mechanism we have to ensure that you know, this coercion is not there, or you know, is it still not as strong as it seems to be?
It's a very interesting question, that too, especially with regard to the family system and the pattern and the beliefs which we have always been having. There's absolutely no doubt that our family patterns and systems are very good. They are all in place. And in fact, you know, the joint family system is slightly, it is in between, it was not working. Mm-hmm. And now it is coming back, trying to coming back also. And as far as our systems are concerned, even if we look at the Mitakshara law, how at all, you know, the Mitakshara law, because we are basically, even today, we are following the same, it is on the basis of a tradition, on the basis of the custom which we had. So even the 1956 Act also came only on that basis. We have not forgotten our roots at all. And but while talking about this, very clearly, definitely there is little inhibition, and there is very clearly there is hesitation. And when the law does not lay down a specific provision or a specific right to a woman, the woman do not want to come forward and then question and challenge and ask that, please give me this, to the family. Primarily because, as you said very rightly, the family cords might get disturbed is one very disturbing aspect. Definitely every woman in the family, every family, in every family, they definitely have it. Because of which, you know, I can even tell you, you know, from my practical, when I heard this question, I can just give from my practical experience. I have handled the cases, and one of the cases which is very special and which I remember in this context is, one of my clients, she was about 75 years of age when she came to me, and after this amendment. And she said that in one small paper, you know, it's a big family of four brothers and two sisters. And she said in a small big paper, I had given at one point of time, you know, that you take the property. In fact, you know, I don't even remember whether, you know, they say that they had given this pay. I have given this paper to them. And even I have also been, you know, a sufferer, because I am not from a very rich family. Mm-hmm. Even as on today, I'm a widow. She was a widow at that point of time at the age of 75. She wanted to reopen and she wanted to take benefit of this. And she has always been a main pillar of the family, and in fact giving support to all brothers and the sisters also, and a very amicable family. Still she felt that, why should my children, I am a widow, and my children, why should they be deprived of it? But when my brothers, all of them through inheritance, are very well off and very comfortable. And she came to me, I filed a suit in Delhi High Court. And ultimately, after maybe about, it took about 5 years and so many rounds of mediation. When Sangeeta was mentioning about the mediation process, I was just remembering that the mediation process is so difficult. Even though I had a senior mediator, because in important cases, in a very complicated cases, the senior mediators are appointed rather than the juniors. So that, because of wide experience which they have, the convincing capacity which they have, so because of that, at least the parties will hear what they say. So because of that, even despite the senior mediator, so there were 3 rounds of mediation, again, back and forth, from court to mediation, mediation to court. But ultimately, definitely, she got her right. She got her portion of the money. And the most interesting part of it is that when her portion of the share was decided and agreed upon, then a small portion of it, she gave it to one of the brother was not alive. One brother was not alive. Mm-hmm. And she gave it to the son of that brother's son out of love and affection.
Wow.
He said, I am not claiming it just like that I want a right. I have to do it. It is just because my children also have to be happy. And at the same time, I want to take care of my brother's son also. The brother who is not here today and who had so much of a repose, so much of a trust on me. So this is one incident which really comes to my mind. But other than that, there have been definitely many, many occasions, such situations wherein the sisters' affidavits are taken from the sisters, and some written document is taken from the sisters. And the minute when the suit, the civil suit, you file it, the defendants, when the brothers and everybody come, all the brothers gang up and they become one single team. And they say, for sister's marriage, there was so much was spent. I only earned and I gave it to them. Father did not give it. Dowry was given. So much we did, so much. For 20 years we have been doing it, and today she is asking money from us. Inheritance, she is imposing her right on us. So this was the kind of a reaction definitely which was there. Because of which every woman had hesitations, of course, in taking and claiming her own right. But now when the law says, yes, you can do it. So at least now when you and me are at one platform, at least the women will not feel guilty, which is more important, which I really feel is one welcoming thing, which law and the honorable courts, not only interpretation, has even widened it. So because of which I'm really happy for the real genuine women of the families. Yeah. If the women want to donate it, they can always donate it, to give it, give a larger portion to the brothers, looking at the situation that they have sacrificed more, or they deserve more. But the, as a right, definitely the women also should be kept at the same platform. That's what is my take on it.
Absolutely. No, that's very well put. And thank you for that narrative, you know, that you just explained.